One of the most controversial struggles of modern society involves the boundaries and the roles set by religion, culture, law, and biology. In some cases, it is a righteous act to fight against those boundaries and roles, such as the struggle for civil rights against the racism of Jim Crow. Likewise, the fight for equal pay for equal work for women is a reflection of God's emphasis on justice. While the church now recognizes that it should have always stood firmly against racism and sexism, even though it did not always live up to that ideal, it is not at all clear within the church as a whole what the response of the people of God should be to the more recent and ongoing campaigns regarding sexual orientation and gender identity. In fact, these issues have split individual churches asunder and threatened to break apart whole denominations. These starkly contrasting conclusions that are reached about these issues in various churches, about what the church's response to our culture should be, arise in part because of a very different understanding about the nature and role of Scripture. While it is unlikely that the church in America will ever have anything close to a consensus on those issues, it would be of great worth if we all understood what Scripture itself is in the same way. For in our text today from 2 Chronicles 26, we will see the price paid by an otherwise good king for presuming to ignore the word of God. Let's look then at 2 Chronicles 26, beginning with the first five verses. It says this: "Then all the people of Judah took Uzziah, who was 16 years old, and made him king in place of his father Amaziah. He was the one who rebuilt Elath and restored it to Judah after Amaziah rested with his fathers. Uzziah was 16 years old when he became king, and he reigned in Jerusalem 52 years. His mother's name was Jecoliah, and she was from Jerusalem. He did what was right in the eyes of the Lord, just as his father Amaziah had done. He sought God during the days of Zechariah, who instructed him in the fear of God. As long as he sought the Lord, God gave him success." We hear that Uzziah was 16 when he became king and reigned for 52 years. Uzziah became king after the death of his father, King Amaziah, who was killed by his own officials. This was the same fate suffered by Uzziah's grandfather, King Joash. If Uzziah is to avoid the tragedy that has dogged his family now for four generations, going all the way back to his great-great-grandfather, Jehoram, who had murdered his own brothers upon ascending the throne and then died by God's judgment of a painful disease of the bowels. That also of his great-great-grandmother, Athaliah, who tried to wipe out the rest of the potential male heirs in her family after the death of his great-grandfather Ahaziah, also by the hand of God's judgment and the sword of Jehu. Uzziah is going to need to be far more dedicated to the Lord than his half-hearted father Amaziah had been, as we learned last week. If all of those names are making your head spin, this summary should help. Uzziah's family has been a disaster as the kings of Judah for four generations in a row. If he doesn't turn things around, there may be little hope left for the nation, not just his own family. But we're told that he did what was right in the eyes of the Lord, just as his father Amaziah had done. That's the formula they use in the Chronicles of the kings of Judah. But having a comparison to Amaziah, who started okay, but we know ended in wickedness and idolatry, that doesn't get my hopes up, saying he was just like his father. Uzziah, as I said, needs to go far beyond the half-hearted obedience of his dad. But we're told that he sought God during the days of Zechariah, who instructed him in the fear of God. That is more like it. It's one thing to obey the law of God. It's far more impressive to be someone who seeks after God That's a relationship with God that Amaziah, his father, lacked, or at least he didn't really value it. Uzziah is avoiding his father's mistake by committing himself to God. Now, we don't know anything else about this Zechariah other than his name, which is actually fairly common. There's lots of Zecharias. It was the name of the prophet that his grandfather had killed. And it's also the name of the prophet that's going to live 200 years later after the Babylonian captivity, whose prophecies bear his name and are part of the Bible. Well, whoever this particular Zechariah was, he did an awesome job and a tremendous service for the entire nation of Judah, because he was able to teach Uzziah the importance of respecting the authority and judgment of God. Whatever he did to make that crucial lesson stick with Uzziah, it worked. And in the end, as long as he sought the Lord, God gave him success. God had always been ready to bless his people if they kept the covenant by obeying the law. Unfortunately, he hasn't had much chance to show that since the death of the last truly good, God-honoring king, Jehoshaphat. That was five generations and probably at least 100 years ago. Because Uzziah took his obedience to God seriously and followed him diligently under Zechariah's tutelage, God was able to bless both Uzziah and the kingdom of Judah tremendously. Following the Lord and living by faith is the key to living a blessed life, not a prosperous and trouble-free life. That may or may not be God's will for any one of us. But more importantly, a life of fulfillment. We are designed to have a fellowship with our Creator. Anything less, no matter how successful in the eyes of the world, is a failure. And any life lived as a disciple of Jesus, firmly committed to the kingdom of God, will be a blessed one, no matter how it turns out. You see, there is no salvation for us under any other name, nor is happiness and fulfillment to be found apart from God. The covenant of Moses contained blessings and curses that reiterated this point, but it's also hardwired into nature itself. Life apart from God must in the end, be empty and hollow. Life as a servant in the house of the Lord must be hope for today and joy in the life to come. Verses 6 through 15, I know that's a long section, just listen as I read the text about the blessings that God gives Uzziah. He went to war against the Philistines and broke down the walls of Gath, Jabneth, and Ashdod. He then rebuilt towns near Ashdod and elsewhere among the Philistines. God helped him against the Philistines and against the Arabs who lived in Gur Baal and against the Moabites. The Ammonites brought tribute to Uzziah, and his fame spread as far as the border of Egypt because he had become very powerful. Uzziah built towns in Jerusalem at the corner gate, at the valley gate, at the angle of the wall, and he fortified them. He also built towers in the desert and dug many cisterns because he had much livestock in the foothills and in the plain. He had people working his fields and vineyards in the hills and in the fertile lands, for he loved the soil. Uzziah had a well-trained army, ready to go out by divisions according to their numbers, as mustered by Jeiel, the secretary, and Maasha, the officer under the direction of Hananiah, one of the royal officials. The total number of family leaders over the fighting men was 2,600. Under their command was an army of 307,500 men trained for war, a powerful force to support the king against his enemies. Uzziah provided shields, spears, helmets, coats of armor, bows, and slingstones for the entire army. In Jerusalem, he made machines designed by skillful men for use on the towers and on the corner defenses to shoot arrows and hurl large stones. His fame spread far and wide, for he was greatly helped until he became powerful. A whole long list of the things, the ways in which God was blessing Uzziah there. It would seem that on every front connected to foreign policy and national defense, not to mention the economy, Uzziah had great success. There have been plenty of American presidents whose blurb in the history textbook falls short of that. The War of 1812, for example, was a disaster for the otherwise capable James Madison, whose own house was burnt down by the British troops. Woodrow Wilson's legacy was tarnished by the failure of the United States Senate to approve his League of Nations. Kennedy was embarrassed by the Bay of Pigs. Vietnam destroyed Johnson's presidency. Even Reagan, who gets a lot of credit for opposing the Soviets so strongly before they fell apart during the Bush presidency, was still tormented by the bombing of the Marine barracks in Lebanon. To navigate foreign policy and national defense successfully is difficult for any leader, whatever type of government he or she may be leading. But because God was with Uzziah, he enjoyed great success on all fronts, such that his fame spread far and wide, for he was greatly helped until he became powerful. Success in foreign endeavors often is, sadly, the ironic seed for eventual failure. Men like Napoleon and Hitler were wildly successful early on, but could not resist the temptation to keep going and going until they had sown the seeds of their own destruction. Uzziah had become both powerful and renowned. It is a combination that often leads to hubris, which marks the beginning of decline. Hubris is a Greek word. It lies at the heart of many of the great Greek tragedies, including Homer's Odyssey, in which the protagonist Odysseus brags that he conquered Troy without needing the help of the gods. The gods' wrath at being slighted subsequently nearly destroys Odysseus and costs him the lives of many of his men. Hubris is excessive pride and self-confidence. It is a big no-no amongst the Greeks. Well, we know God isn't a big fan of it either. But it is not foreign policy that will trouble Uzziah, nor even domestic policy, where he also enjoyed great success. And it won't be personal relationships with his family or his officials that blow up in his face. The hubris of Uzziah will show itself in an unexpected place and lead to an outcome few would have foreseen at the height of his success. So let's see what happens because of his pride, verses 16 to 18. But after Uzziah became powerful, his pride led to his downfall. He was unfaithful to the Lord his God and entered the temple of the Lord to burn incense on the altar of incense. Azariah the priest, with 80 other courageous priests of the Lord, followed him in. They confronted him and said, "It is not right for you, Uzziah, to burn incense to the Lord. That is for the priests, the descendants of Aaron, who have been consecrated to burn incense. Leave the sanctuary, for you have been unfaithful, and you will not be honored by the Lord God." After Uzziah became powerful, his pride led to his downfall. After such high hopes and significant successes, it will not be outside influences that bring about Uzziah's downfall, but as it always is with sin, the temptation comes from our own hearts. For Uzziah, it will be the oldest of sins that ensnares him, pride. Pride brought about the downfall of the angel Lucifer, who desired to be like God instead of worshiping and obeying his creator, and was thus banished from heaven. Adam and Eve followed suit, losing out on paradise because they would not respect the authority of God, but instead sought to put their own desire above it. At the heart of all sin is the desire to put our own will above that of God. That is, of course, a desire born of pride. The action that happens as a result of this desire, whether that be sexual sin or greed or violence or some other, they all are reflections of a willingness to ignore the law of God and put our own will above it. What but pride could so blind mortal man that we would think ourselves capable of ignoring Almighty God? Uzziah might have ignored the law of God by committing adultery like David, or he might have followed the idolatrous ways of his father and his grandfather. It wouldn't really matter how his pride manifested itself in sin. That he had pride, sufficient to convince him to ignore God, was enough. Sin was inevitable at that point. We're told that he was unfaithful to the Lord his God. This is the end result of pride's gestation in sin. God not only deserves our respect and obedience, he demands it. When we set up our own judgment against that of God, we are not only being unfaithful to the relationship that God would have with his people, we are also doomed to fail. This is why we take the Bible so seriously. The Bible is what God has chosen to reveal to us concerning his will, his law, and his actions in our world. It is from this word that we learn to know and understand the will of God, that we might conform our own hearts and minds with the power of the Holy Spirit to it. If the authority of the Bible is doubted, the wickedness of the human heart will seek to establish its own authority in the place of what God has revealed. This is not to say that our interpretation of the Bible must not be questioned. We can certainly be wrong about that. Nor is it to say that a human authority must be obeyed, which is claiming to represent God's authority. For the church has made many mistakes and been in error over the years. It is instead the Bible itself which must be our foundational authority. We can disagree about how to understand and apply it without undermining its authority if we all agree that the Word of God is the authority to which we must appeal to defend our attitudes, our thought processes, or our actions. It is for this reason that I've been teaching the history of the Bible 5 minutes each week. Why we hold 2 Bible studies each week, and why our Awana Kids program focuses on Bible verse memorization. Also, it's why I preach directly from the text each week, encouraging you to read along, consider what I say, and then weigh it, always, against what the Word of God says, in order to ensure that I'm bringing you God's Word and not my own. These are some of the most prominent examples of how the Bible is foundational for everything we believe and do. If pride were to infest this local assembly of God's people, a sure sign of its arrival would be a diminished view of God's Word. Let us then return to Uzziah. How did pride manifest itself in actions which ignored the Word of God? Very simply, he entered the temple of the Lord to burn incense. Now, to the casual observer, the casual reader, this doesn't look like an act of pride in defiance of the authority of the law of God. Doesn't even seem like much of an offense at all. To go to the temple of the Lord looks like an act of piety, and it would naturally be a good thing. So why is Uzziah making a big mistake? The privilege and duty of burning incense at the temple, along with the other priestly duties in the sacrificial system of the Mosaic Law, belonged exclusively to the descendants of Moses' brother Aaron, who were chosen by God to fulfill this crucial role. Moses and Aaron were members of the tribe of Levi. God chose this tribe as his sacred representatives, with the men from the tribe that weren't directly descended from Aaron serving as assistants to the priests. The descendants of Aaron and the rest of the Levites were the only ones authorized to serve at the temple. No member of any other Jewish tribe, for any reason, could fulfill that role. We know that Uzziah is a descendant of David, of the tribe of Judah. It is thus clearly spelled out in the law of Moses that he can have no priestly function whatsoever. It isn't about what Uzziah or any other non-Levite might want to do. It's about what God has commanded them to do. The motive for Uzziah's presumptive move can only be guessed at. We know that his pride caused him to think that he could ignore the law. But why would he want to? When King Saul usurped the role of Samuel by offering a sacrifice before an impending battle, it was out of fear that Samuel would not arrive in time to seek God's blessing before that fight. Saul was punished for his lack of trust and patience. That act was one of the reasons why the kingship was taken away from Saul and given to David. What did Uzziah have to gain by offering incense at that altar? It was common for pagan kings in the lands around Israel and Judah to have also a priestly role to increase their authority over the people that they ruled. Alexander the Great and Caesar Augustus would later embrace that mixture of politics and religion as a means of supporting their rule, as have many kings before and after them, with one of the more recent examples being Henry VIII. Henry VIII decided to name himself the head of the Church of England to avoid having to listen to the Pope in Rome about that silly divorce thing that he wanted to do. Uzziah's father and grandfather both had offered sacrifices in their worship of foreign gods. And while those gods evidently did not appeal to Uzziah, the desire to increase his authority at the expense of the priests by usurping a portion of their role seems to have tempted him. When combined with his pride, it convinced Uzziah that he could get away with ignoring the word of the Lord and what it said on this matter. Perhaps that was his reason. Greed for more power is usually a safe bet when history doesn't give us enough information as to why a ruler does what they do. Whatever the cause, Uzziah's action is a gross violation of the law of God. What are the priests going to do about it? We're told that Azariah and 80 other, it's the typo there, 80 other courageous priests followed him in and confronted him. Why did it take courage for Azariah and the rest of the priests to confront their king when he was clearly in the wrong? Perhaps you're not aware of the long history of kings not taking correction well. Kings and other various dictators and absolute rulers often become like spoiled children. Because they get their way in everything, they throw a fit when someone tells them no. The decision of Azariah to confront the king was absolutely morally and ethically the right thing to do. It might also be the last thing he ever does. So he said to the king, "It's not right for you to burn incense to the Lord. It's for the priests, the descendants of Aaron." Azariah doesn't beat around the bush. He flat out tells the king that he is in the wrong. How does Azariah know that Uzziah is wrong? Because it is written in the Holy Scriptures. Azariah need not invoke his own authority. He didn't even have to appeal to tradition and say, "This is the way we've always done it." Because the truth that he is defending has been established by God through his divine revelation to his servant Moses, whose very words have been preserved in the Torah, the writings of Moses. So he's on firm ground when he says that. He says to the king, "Leave the sanctuary, for you've been unfaithful and will not be honored by God." Because Azariah is standing firmly upon the scriptures and not on his own opinion, he can say without being judgmental that God will not honor what Uzziah has chosen to do. When we speak in defense of the word of God, it is not our authority that we are defending, but God's, which is why we cannot afford to mix those two things together by claiming God's authority for our opinions. What God has said will stand, for it is the truth. What we say will stand or fall according to how it conforms to that truth of God. No individual Christian, no church or denomination will be blessed of God for rejecting the teaching of his word. It is for us to proclaim the word of God, not alter it. Often enough, both sides in the debate between Christians are claiming that the other side is ignoring scripture or perverting it. It's of course God who will judge and not us. Whether we see clearly or not, God will hold those responsible who are mistreating his word. Before we finish by looking at God's response to Uzziah, we should note that Azariah was confronting a fellow Israelite, a member like him of the covenant, someone under the authority of Scripture. To do so is not being nosy. It's not being holier than thou. It is a sacred duty. We need to look after each other. We need to correct each other when we err. We do not expect unbelievers to live morally and obey God's word. How are they to do so without the Spirit? But we do expect our fellow Christians to walk as Jesus did, in accordance with the teachings of the Bible. And here, in our local assembly, it is our duty to help each other do so. Verses 19 and 20. Uzziah had a censer in his hand, ready to burn incense. He became angry. While he was raging at the priests in their presence, before the incense altar in the temple, in the Lord's temple, leprosy broke out on his forehead. When Azariah, the chief priest, and all the other priests looked at him, they saw that he had leprosy on his forehead, so they hurried him out. Indeed, he himself was eager to leave, because the Lord had afflicted him. So you have Uzziah with the censer in hand, angry for being corrected. Despite his clear violation of the law of God, Uzziah was given a chance to repent, which he angrily spurned. It was the choice of a moment, but it reflected his heart. Sadly for Uzziah, he's going to have to live with the consequences of this angry decision for the rest of his life. It says, while he was raging at the priests, in their presence, before the altar of the Lord, leprosy broke out on his forehead. I don't know of any actual instances of anyone being struck by lightning for sinning in church, but I know that sitcoms continue to think that that gag is really funny. I've seen it so many times. Uzziah's sin was being done at the very altar of the Lord, in the temple. God sees all men everywhere, so hiding sin from him is, of course, impossible. But sinning on holy ground is just spitting in God's face. That's not a good idea. I wouldn't recommend it. God chose to deal with Uzziah's sin immediately. Sometimes God does that. Sometimes, by his grace, God holds back his wrath for a while. Leprosy was a skin disease that was contagious. It was greatly feared in the ancient world and specifically addressed in the law of Moses. All those suffering from leprosy had to live apart from society, cut off from worship at the temple and contact with their families, until they were healed. It was perhaps the most devastating diagnosis for an Israelite, as it had health implications, societal implications, and religious consequences. They saw that he had leprosy on his forehead, so they hurried him out. Indeed, he himself was eager to leave. Even Uzziah's great pride was no match for leprosy. He knew his own authority as king was in jeopardy, for all would see this sudden onslaught of leprosy for what it really was, a sign of the displeasure of God. 21 to 23, we get the end. King Uzziah had leprosy until the day he died. He lived in a separate house, leprous and excluded from the temple of the Lord. Jotham, his son, had charge of the palace and governed the people of the land. The other events of Uzziah's reign from beginning to end are recorded by the prophet Isaiah, son of Amos. Uzziah rested with his fathers and was buried near them in the field for burial that belonged to the kings. For people said, he had leprosy. And Jotham, his son, succeeded him as king. He lived apart until the day he died, excluded from the temple, with his son taking over. Uzziah's prideful defiance of the word of God and his angry reaction when he was called to repent from it had consequences for the rest of his life. He ended his days alone, cut off, while his son ruled in his place. Such a successful and good king, brought low by pride and relegated to a house of shame. God doesn't take defiance of his word lightly. He's no fan of pride either. Even in death, Uzziah was not buried alongside his father. Kings and others, that were, the other kings there, men that were far less capable, men that were outwardly far more wicked than he was, and yet he was buried apart. He paid a terrible price for placing his own judgment above that of God. The lesson for us then is simple enough. God has given us his word. Its authority is absolute. To defy the word of God is a fool's errand. It will end badly. As the people of God, we are bound by the teachings of the Bible. We may not always agree on exactly what those are, but we had better get on board with bowing our will to its authority. To defy the Bible is to defy the Lord God. May the Lord protect us from ever failing him so rebelliously. May the Lord bring us to repentance and forgive us if we ever do.